you've been worldwide known for your great cave dives and your deep dives, and then you combined them and made a lot of deep cave dives, and you hold two Guinness Book records, world records, for the deepest dive and the deepest cave dive. And when you was writing Beyond Blue, the book that we are speaking about today, about your past achievements, which of the chapters brought you most pleasure to write about?
I think probably the one that I enjoyed the most was the Shaq Exley one.
And why?
I think that particular chapter was probably the time when I learned the most about deep diving. Up to that stage, I'd been deep diving, but I've been deep diving like in a vacuum, totally. Well, nobody taught me to dive with Trimix. There were no books about Trimix diving, so I did everything. I worked it out myself. There were not even tables for decompression on Trimix. Then, when I met Shaq Exley, it was another dimension, because South Africa was also a bit isolated from the rest of the world. And so during the 2 weeks that we spent diving at Boesman's Gat with Shaq Exley, I was learning a lot. I think even Shaq Exley also learned something, because he was amazed at the short decompressions that I was doing. His decompressions at that time were a bit longer, but, you know, and so it became, but for me, there were new techniques that came up, and so I enjoyed that quite a bit.
Would you rather call Shaq Exley your friend or rather your teacher?
Well, I think it may be a combination. Although he wasn't really there to teach me, but I think we became friends, although we were rivals in a way as well. Because he soon realized that one day I was going to try and go for his record. But I think I'd like to call him a friend, you know.
Did he give you some advices, or did he encourage you to push the limits?
Well,
to try his record?
Yeah, he indirectly did. I don't know if he was trying to kill me quickly.
Because just to get rid of the rival.
Yeah. But you said, why don't you take all my equipment and go to the bottom? And at that time, my deepest dive was like 153. Now, we all know that when you dive, you must only introduce one new piece of equipment per dive. Now, putting on a dry suit, which I never dived with before, putting on his cylinders, his massive cylinders, which I never dived with before, all the stuff was like not what I was used to.
That
so I was
like
certainly
some...
gonna be dead.
That looks like a dead end.
So I politely declined. I rather took my dry suit and I dived with like twin tens to 177 meters. So, you know, not a big gas user. So he was also quite surprised how I could go so deep with such small cylinders. It was interesting for him, but yeah, no, I learned all the way. And the best thing of all is He wrote a decompression program called Dr. X, which he was making available to me. It was actually available for sale. So I got a copy of that. And I used that.
And how did you react when you learned about his accident, that he died?
No, I was completely surprised, to say that. I was completely taken aback. First of all, I didn't know he was going to do that dive on that day. I was in France at the time, playing underwater hockey at the World Underwater Hockey Championships. It's the CMAS World Championships in France. And then I got the message that he had died, and I was quite surprised. I mean, to me, he's like immortal, and so I was shocked, and I was very sorry to hear that that he had died. I was not happy at all about that.
But probably he expected that. There is this famous quote that if you dive in the caves, you will die in the caves. Did he expect that one day death will come to grab him?
Well, look, the thing is, you know, Shaq Exley's one job was to recover the bodies of dead cave divers. He probably, if I have to remember correctly, he recovered hundreds of bodies of cave divers in Florida. So he'd seen enough of it. So, I don't think that anyone expects it, you know, and, yeah, it's definitely always a possibility.
Did you think about such possibility during your dives?
Well, I when I go for a dive, I'm not thinking about it at all. I go into it with a complete confidence, and it doesn't even, it's not part of the equation. So I think it shouldn't be. Otherwise, if you think you're going to die, or if there's a good possibility of dying, then scrap it. Don't do it. Because that works negatively against you. So you can do the logistics and the planning, and then you're going to sit down and evaluate it. And then if it doesn't work, then don't do it. But you can die on a 3 meter cave dive.
Yeah.
3 meter deep cave dive.
Yeah.
If you mess it up enough.
Or in the street.
Yeah, in the street, yeah. You can walk across the street and die.
When I read your book, I had that feeling, you know, especially at the beginning, more and more people die in your book, and with every next diver you are like you react less and less, like you are immunized to that messages, to that sad messages.
Yes.
About death. Is it possible at all to get used to such bad messages and still push your limits at the same time?
Well, I think you kind of put it at the back of your mind, and especially if you're not involved directly, it's easy to set it aside.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you cannot sort of overanalyze those things. You need to have a look at it, why it happened. But if it's going to affect you so much, then your diving is not going to happen. So you need, it's not like you're going to become immune.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to, but it does tend to kind of numb you after a while.
Mm-hmm.
But that is a problem, quite a problem, because people are looking at others that are dying in diving and they're going to say, oh, he died because he made this mistake and that mistake and that mistake. I wouldn't have done it, and so on.
So it's like a very painful learning curve?
Yeah, look, yeah, it's virtually impossible now to analyze everybody's death too fully, because, you know, in CMAS we always had an inquiry. We had a complete report and we analyzed exactly what the causes of the death were. Lately that doesn't seem to be any such thing. It just,
why?
Just died. Nobody really seems to go into exactly why or what.
Into the investigation.
Yeah. The investigations don't seem to be there anymore. I don't know why. It seems like people are skipping over that.
And it's, do you think it's a fault, it's a pity?
Yeah, definitely, because if you look at that Shank Exley book on cave diving,
Blueprints for Survival.
Yeah, it's based on all the fatalities,
yeah,
and the mistakes that they, yeah, made.
And every of them is evaluated.
Yes. But now it's not happening. People are just dying and say, well, he just died.
So does it mean that we are not learning on the mistakes of the others?
It seems like we are not really learning too much. You know, there should be more emphasis on determining exactly. I mean, I've got that rebreather fatality check, sort of a fatality list.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a lot of divers that died. It says cause of death unknown. So they don't even know why the guy died. So I find that disturbing, I think.
Mm-hmm.
There doesn't seem to be accountability,
mm-hmm,
for anything like that.
Mm-hmm. What drove you personally so deep? Why? What was your motivation to dive so deep?
Well, originally, like I said, I didn't have. I was just trying to see how deep I can go. So I wasn't. I was going deeper, and then I thought, well, that was fine. Let's see if I can go a bit deeper. The next time I went a bit deeper again, and I just kept on going. And then one day I kind of woke up and I saw, well, I'm getting close to a record now. And then in the case of Boesman's Gat, I also had it was a combination. I saw that I was close to a record, and also a policeman found me and said, there's a body down there, can you bring it up? So I said, hang on, to do this body recovery, I must break a world record. I thought, let me think about this. And then after a while, I thought, okay, let's give it a try. And then I got to the bottom and I didn't find the body. Which maybe was a lucky thing. And then that was the record.
How deep was it?
That was close to 283 meters. But the biggest difference there being the altitude. So the Deco was actually for 339 meters. So that was a fairly major, a major dive. Then what happened after that? That was the overall deep diving record. That stood for a few years. Think what, 5 years or something. Then John Bennett came along. He beat my record. And he went to 307 or 308 meters. And then I thought, okay, I'm going to plan for that. And I started planning on it. Then we had the Cilicant expedition and started doing quite deep dives in the sea. And I thought, well, this is actually quite nice. And then eventually, Leszek through Witold contacted me and they said that Leszek wanted to do some deep diving in Boesmanschat. So we put that together, and those dives were like build-up dives as well. So I was getting back into it, and then while planning for the other deeper dive, and I managed to get sponsorship from a whole lot of diving companies and also from Leszek himself, from his bank. Although I wasn't expecting it, it was a complete surprise. And then I went for it the first time. My regulator stopped working and I nearly killed myself. And then decided to go again, then made it. Beat John Bennett's record with about 10 meters.
So it was 300?
Yeah, it was his dive was 308. Mm-hmm. And mine was 318. The actual depth was about...
And 25 centimeters.
Yes, but it was a little... yeah. Because it's measured exactly. You should be able to know exactly what the depth is.
And now people are beating records. And what kind of proof would you like to see from the record that is beaten?
Well, I think if you're going to do a record, it's not for me to see the proof. You need, I think the main thing is to have an established sort of entity that can verify. I know for Guinness World Record for sure is quite used to these things. So I think if you're going to do a record, you're going to take all the time and money to do the thing, you must make sure that you can prove it.
Like, you mean films from the dive, or you should show your computers?
Well, a combination. It's, you know, the problem with the computers is they can't really go so deep. You know, there's a lot of computers, people are making claims it can go well over 300 meters. I believe that still today there is not a computer that will be reliable past 300 meters. Mm-hmm. If it gets there.
So the calibrated line with some...
A calibrated line with markers in the sea, as long as the line is vertical, mm-hmm. is probably the best way. Mm-hmm. There's, I mean, all the computers that I dove with, I was told, no problem, it's going to make it to 300 meters. And by about 290, they
died.
The pressure sensor was collapsing. Mm. The best computer that I had was an old UATAC Parkway computer. It went past 300 meters.
The only one.
The only one. But on my record dive, it also died. But it died at something like 309 meters or something like that.
In your book, you write very warmly about Polish divers, about Leszek Czarnecki, whom you have already mentioned, and about Krzysztof Starnawski. What is so special about that Polish divers?
Well, I think the first thing is they were prepared to help me, you know, without any kind of recompense as such. And I found that amazing, you know, that a lot of the divers I didn't know on initially, but they were prepared to help me in a dive like that, you know, after I knew some of the divers from the first attempt, then divers like Andre and so on, they said to their friends, come also along and it was I think the warmth and integrity of the divers that came on the trip, mm-hmm. that were prepared to help me, and a lot of them didn't even know me at that time. So it's not usual that people would go out of their way to help someone that they don't even know, kind of.
It's typical Polish hospitality, you know.
Yeah.
And didn't they invite you to dive in the Baltic Sea, in our shipwreck diving paradise?
Well, we had the one opportunity, a brief opportunity, but on that occasion the weather was really bad. I think it was in November. It was a few years back. And then we never got around to diving. But yeah, I think, I don't know when the best time is to dive in the Baltic.
Well, a little earlier than in November, because it's rather storm season.
Yeah. Well, I think at the one time Leszek had a plan to dive on one of the wrecks of the Baltic. And he was inviting me to do it. But then the plans changed. And then it changed to the Bikini Atoll.
Which is not bad.
Yeah. So instead of diving in the Baltic, we rather went to the Bikini Atoll. And that was really good. Yeah. So that was good. Very good.
I found the passage in your book at the beginning, where you write, it's not worth to deal with the past. It's better to make plans for the future. Uh-huh. Something like that. So what are those plans? Are you coming back to the Baltic, or as you call yourself in the book, you are only recreational diver now and engineer. So do you plan to go only to the coral reefs of Dahab?
No. No. I mean, that's all relative. I think I'm still going to do some deep diving. I'm not sure how deep, but well, it's definitely not just...
What does it mean, deep, for you?
Yeah, look, I think deep, if you got to define deep, it's anything deeper than 30 meters.
Okay.
But certainly I'm not going to stick to that. I would certainly like to do quite a few dives below 100 meters and so on. But exactly how deep I'll get to, I don't know. I'll have to work on it.
Any special area that you would like to visit still?
Well, I've got a condo in Florida. And it's about 1 kilometer from the sea. And there's a lot of wrecks there. Some of them are quite deepish. So I'm going to start there and work my way and see what else we can find in that area.
With your book, what would you like, what is the message that you would like to tell to the younger generation of divers?
I think my message is try and keep diving as simple as possible. Don't overcomplicate it. Enjoy it. Do it for pleasure. And you see, the thing is, I see the tendency lately of people diving with excess equipment for the dives that they are doing. I'm not criticizing anyone, but I see people diving at like 15 meters with a canister light and twins and dry suit, and that works. You don't need all that to enjoy the diving. I mean, you can do that dive with a single cylinder and not even a big one at that. But people are over complicating the dives. I think one thing to enjoy diving is to keep it as simple as possible. And also because of all of that, when you've got so much equipment, it's becoming expensive. And you're not attracting more divers, but rather only allowing divers that have got a lot of money to dive. So try to keep it simpler and more accessible so that you can have more divers.
And always try to find as much fun as you can.
Yeah, you're doing it for fun, not for punishment.
So I wish you a lot of fun, a lot of joy in the diving, and I wish you good luck with the book.
Thanks.
Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot.